Hello viewers, welcome to this exclusive fireside chat between two thought leaders. This fireside chat is a part of series that focuses on mapping the business impact of learning. This is a special series created to showcase the significance of effective learning in the workplace and the unique strategy deployed by industry experts to mitigate skill loss. From the industry, we have Ina Bajwa. Ina heads learning and development across the globe for Tata Communications. In this role, she spearheads the learning transformation journey of reskilling, upskilling, and cross-skilling, and developing people, managers, and leaders to create a sustainable business impact. Hello to this show, Ina.
Thank you, Pooja. My pleasure to be here.
Along with Ina, we have Raghav Gupta. Raghav leads Coursera in India and APAC. He is responsible for growing Coursera's consumer and enterprise business in the region, thereby bringing the world's best education to learners across Asia Pacific. Welcome to the show, Raghav.
Thanks, Pooja. Pleasure to be here and good to be here with Ina as well. Thank you.
So we begin the fireside chat with first question to Ina. Tata Communication has been one of the few early adopters of online learning. How was your response to the pandemic last year and how has learning strategy evolved since then?
Sure, thanks, Pooja. The last year actually has been incredible, right? With lots of changes, but lots of opportunities too. And amidst all of it, learning has moved to the forefront and people have recognized that learning is no longer a nice to have, but it's a must to have because the shelf life of skills is just 3 to 5 years. And companies and employees need to constantly learn and reinvent themselves. And in this changing world, there is a need to keep up. And for many of the challenges that we're facing today, learning has been considered as the answer. So to ensure that there's a continuous quest to learn, learning and development initiatives at Tata Communications have always been aligned with the business needs. And the L&D team engages with the leaders, the managers, as well as the employees throughout the year to align the solutions. And the pandemic has only propelled us to the digital adoption of learning from 90% to 100% today. And, you know, we're now at the leading edge of having the learning culture in the company where employees are self-driven to learn further and build their capabilities. Now, how is our L&D strategy aligned and how has it changed? Well, you know, last year was the first year of our L&D strategy in line with the newly updated company strategy. And it offers a three-tiered approach, which basically balances high impact development focus with here and now upskilling requirements and with that of democratization of learning where employees can learn, you know, anything that helps them grow in their professional and personal fronts. And we've actually taken a platform strategy approach to L&D and our primary learning interface, which we call as Tata Communications Learning Academy, hosts everything related to L&D for our employees. So it offers a very good mix of freemium and sponsored content, as well as curated content from L&D based on different themes. And our ecosystem is fully digitized and it helps us in further strengthening the culture of continuous learning and keeping employees and the business needs at the center. Now, the last year saw the strategy in action and we were able to leverage TCLA in just a few hours time, not only to make them learn on key skills, but also to educate them on, let's say, hand hygiene, social distancing at the start of the pandemic, and later, you know, with the well-being initiatives and the vaccination drives, of what would have taken us enormous amount of time doing it without technology in the previous years.
Thanks, Ina. Going to you, Raghav, definitely the pandemic has accelerated transformation in organization, which has created a big need for learning. And definitely learning has gone up in the last 1 year. So what are the biggest trends you are seeing in organizations? How are they, you know, accelerating learning programs?
Yeah, absolutely, Pooja. We've seen many of this happen in the country, you know, outside the country as well, around the world, and also on the Coursera platform. And before I share some of the insights, you know, big compliments to Ina and her team at Tata Communications. We've been watching the kind of massive transformation they've been driving at the company through L&D, and it's amazing this program that they've been running. So firstly, like you said, right, we've seen learning increase quite significantly last year, you know, and if I use some data points to support this, on the Coursera platform in India, there were 5 million learners in January last year. We closed the year with 11 million learners. So it doubled, more than doubled. And we've also seen in corporate learning and development, you know, employees on an average were spending 40, 42 hours per year, you know, in the country in general. And there are reports which say that it went up to 100 hours per year per employees. So we've genuinely seen the time that is being spent on learning and development go up. And in my conversations, not just with learning leaders, but also HR leaders, CDOs, CTOs, you know, learning and development of talent used to be one of the agenda items in the top five. Many folks are talking about it as being their number one agenda item. And the reason for that is, you know, we were already seeing technology impacting how we work, but we've seen COVID accelerate the adoption of that technology. And Ina spoke about how they are on this digitization journey as well. What we saw, which was very interesting on the Coursera platform last year, is we looked at what is it that working professionals learned on the Coursera platform in 2019, and how did it change in 2020? And the difference couldn't be more, you know, amazing and more interesting. In 2019, a lot of the learning was around functional skills. So people were learning technology, Python, data science, and so on and so forth. But in 2020, a lot of this shifted to skills like communication. It shifted to skills like gratitude, kindness, mindfulness, and so on. So this importance of human skills came to the fore along with, you know, digital skills that we were seeing. And we've been looking at what organizations like World Economic Forum are projecting in terms of what skills might be needed in the next 3, 4, 5 years. And it's very clear that the message is that future of skilling needs to be a combination of digital and human skills, right? So many of us who work in industry will need digital skills, will need data skills, and will need human skills as well. And I think one of the key elements in all of this has been leadership in these human skills, right? To be able to lead a virtual team is very different from leading a team of people, you know, managing and getting together in person. And also through all of this time, how do we all manage our own happiness, you know, irrespective of what's happening at work? Because at the end of the day, we are human beings. We are not just, you know, industrial workers. So we've seen on the Coursera platform, you know, courses around the science of well-being have taken off in a big way. This is a course from Yale University. We've also seen, you know, launching content around how to manage a virtual team, which we've launched on our platform, has been quite helpful as well. So if I were to summarize, you know, lots more learning, definitely. A lot more prioritization towards talent development and learning from business leaders, you know, along with learning leaders. And then this whole shift to not just functional digital skills, but also digital and human skills. Those would be possibly my top headlines, so to say.
Very valid points, Raghav. Thank you for that. And I totally agree that human skills is more essential today. And, you know, some of the leaders who are coming to our webinars, they're talking about human skills is digital skills plus soft skills. So very interesting to know that. Ina, my next question to you is, what's your strategy on hiring new skill talent versus upskilling internal talent with emerging skills? What are the key skills you will be focusing on?
Sure, Pooja. See, some of the largest enterprises globally have seen this shift coming closer in the last few years. And if I may say, they've invested millions and even billions in future-proofing their employees, arming them with skills needed in the new world of work. And the two key buzzwords there is upskilling and reskilling. And, you know, I would say that there's not a one-size-fits-all approach in terms of how to strategically plan, resource, and execute them. And based on my understanding, majority of the people are actually working with their people managers to drive that learner engagement and skill building. At Tata Communications, what we've done is that we've identified critical roles and functions across our value chain and enabled role-based academies, you know, which cater to holistic role development, either for the current skills, for the current role, or for the transformed role with a key focus on future skills, which are required to execute our strategy. And like Raghav very rightly said that, you know, it's not just the technical skills or the digital skills that will be required for us to sustain in the future or for any organization to sustain well in the future, but it's a good mix of digital as well as the non-digital or the human skills that are actually required to add that finesse to a company's competitive advantage. So the academies, actually, we kicked off 6 of them last year, and we plan to introduce 4 more this year. And this learning is not just knowledge-based sessions, but it involves intense practice of learned skills, assessments, on-the-job experience. And for initiatives like these to deliver the impact, L&D cannot own the development agenda. So, there is a very high level of co-ownership by our business leaders, and the impact metrics are tracked regularly to assess if any course corrections are required. And, we also, of course, we heavily leverage Coursera because it offers a wide range of learning content across key themes, especially artificial intelligence, cybersecurity, mobility, leadership, and they've also introduced a lot of fantastic courses. So we leverage them along with a couple of other providers that we have. And in terms of our strategy of hiring versus developing, I would say that our primary focus is to actually develop emerging skills via reskilling and upskilling internally. And we hire only for niche skills where the requirement is immediate and the development internally is not really feasible. So that's what I would say, Pooja.
Sure, Ina. So I'll take a cue from what Ina's already said, that you're using artificial intelligence and you are helping them develop certain courses and certain content for learning. So Raghav, in which other way are you using digital technologies of today to create a learning ecosystem for your partners?
Yeah, so I'm going to actually, Pooja, echo a lot of what Ina has said, right? And this seems like one of those fireside chat where both of us are going to agree with each other quite a bit instead of, having different points of view. But I think what she shared is just fantastic. Given the high importance of learning and development, I don't think individuals or organizations have time to figure out what to learn. I think there used to be a time when we would say, look, give an ocean of content and people will figure it out, right? I think we've moved to a point where very specific job relevant skill-based learning for direct business impact is where I think many corporate learning programs are heading towards. And we've seen a lot of success with 3 things that we've launched, where I think corporate learning and development is seeing quite a bit of resonance, quite a bit of business benefits. These are academies, skill sets, and hands-on learning. And Ina spoke about academies, so I'm not going to repeat that. But we've seen that as many organizations undergo a digital journey, their businesses, I think statistics tell us that 90% businesses are getting more and more digital in the country around the world as well. And in topics like data science and analytics, cloud and IT, software engineering, marketing, finance, even leadership, we've put together these academies which tell you, depending on the role that you have and the level of reskilling or upskilling that you might need, here's the learning that you might need to take. In the marketing academy, we are learning that actually CMOs are spending more money on technology than they are on people, because marketing is becoming more and more technology-led as opposed to people-led. So, the marketing academy is not just marketing alone, but it is marketing and technology together that we're kind of bringing to people. And we've also found that, again, so that we move away towards more business impactful learning programs, we've launched this new kind of a thing last year called skill sets. And the idea is to say that, look, if you're today a business analyst, you want to become a data analyst because that's where your organization is headed. We can tell you which are the 5 skills that you should build as a data analyst. We can tell you what is the level of proficiency that you should acquire in those skills. We can tell you what is your level of proficiency today. And then we can give you courses and projects to be able to get to that level of proficiency. So the level of sophistication in corporate learning has really grown, I would say, leaps and bounds. And the last thing that we've done is we've said, along with knowledge, let's provide the opportunity to practice as well. And we launched something called guided projects. The idea here is that, again, just taking this business analyst who became a data analyst example, this data analyst might need to learn a software called Tableau so that he or she can visualize data. And to practice that software is extremely important. And you can come to a guided project on Coursera on Tableau and actually in a virtual machine, practice on the Tableau software without needing to buy it and install it and all of that stuff. So I think some of these elements are delivering quite a good rate of success. And I think, you know, we're seeing some good results coming. I think what Ina shared is exactly along those lines as well.
Thank you, Raghav. Very valid points there. Ina, so how do you map the impact of learning on the business outcome? That's very important, you know. So do the learners,
See, the learning leaders actually have to rely on a wide spectrum of measures to gauge success and identify areas to improve. And, you know, there are a lot of ways to actually map that impact. It could be including the number of learners who keep coming back to the online platforms, how many courses the employees have completed, time saved, productivity increase, or just the sheer ability to retain talent within the organizations are a couple of ways to measure impact. At Tata Communications, you know, last year, like I mentioned, was an exceptional time for everyone around. But in spite of the pandemic, we saw that our learners finished with 9.5 days of average learning days per employee, which led to a 35% increase in total learning person days. And this was the first year that we crossed 1 lakh total learning days last year, to be precise, 1,12,000. And, you know, we measure the effectiveness of our L&D initiatives basically based on a learner experience strategy, which is based on critical moments that a learner experiences, and that's called the NPS. And the NPS for us was last year 84. And furthermore, you know, we just got our engagement scores. We do a lot of pulse surveys during the year, but we also do an annual engagement survey. And the score on learning was 85%, which was quite high than the benchmark scores, you know, across the industry. And this year, you know, as we get into the second year and academies will take much more shape, we're focusing on really, you know, driving impact on two areas. One is business, and, you know, in business, really linking how some of the skills are contributing to either the process improvements or, you know, just share top line or bottom line business performance, and also the talent pipeline development metrics. So that's one area. On the other hand side, on the employee impact, we will be measuring ourselves against the satisfaction as well as the employee progression metrics as a result of the academies.
And if I can quickly say, 84 NPS is just incredible. It is unheard of. So congratulations to you guys.
Yeah, that's good. So Raghav, you know, the workplace is mutating very rapidly. There is, you know, hybrid working models are changing the way they look continuously. So how do you see enterprise learning evolving to keep up with the pace of what the workplace needs?
Yeah, and I'll keep this brief in the interest of time as well, Pooja. Like I was saying, we're seeing a big focus on business outcomes being delivered from learning via a focus on skills first learning. And as I was mentioning earlier, you know, I would say maybe 4 years ago, 3 years ago, a lot of learning used to be what one would call basically open learning, right? Provide learning to an individual and let them figure it out a little bit, right? It was a little bit of let's put a big content catalog in front of people and, you know, let them figure it out. We saw that move to what I would call guided learning. So instead of just an ocean of content, it was a little bit of, you know, here's something in data, or here's something in digital, or here's something in leadership and something like that. And from that, I think what we've been talking a little bit about is this big focus towards skills first learning, you know, developing critical skills, you know, not starting with the content in mind, but starting with the business outcome in mind, and then saying, what are those courses, what are those projects that can help deliver the kind of skilling that is needed. And I think along with the skills first approach, being very focused on hands-on as well. So gaining knowledge, but also gaining the practice to be able to apply some of those skills. I think that's what we've seen corporate learning has moved towards. I would imagine that's where a lot of the trends will continue to be.
Lastly, Ina, one challenge that you foresee as, you know, a consistent challenge during pandemic or in a post-pandemic work world, you know, with respect to skilling, which employees face?
It's interesting you ask, Pooja. In fact, you know, being a learning leader, almost on a daily basis, I have conversations with my team members on this. It's actually the management of time. Because, you know, the pandemic has just made people take a U-turn on how they were leading their lives earlier. And there was some bit of balance earlier. But now, you know, with so much pressure that people are facing, even in their jobs, to deliver to the results while working from home. And, you know, working from home is a welcome change for a lot of people. But at the same time, in certain employee segments, for example, for people who are caretakers of elder parents or who are young parents taking care of children, dual career couples, I think the pressure is just enormous, right? And taking out time after a regular day of work to regular day of meetings, I would say, to accommodate a few hours of real work and then being able to learn is really, really a hard challenge. And at Tara Communications, we're actually this year prioritizing a lot of learning. You know, at an organization level, we are driving a lot of things, but for specific teams, we've taken it upon ourselves to say, look, you don't need to do everything. This is what is expected out of you to deliver impact and just focus on that. So that's what I would say.
Raghav, going to you, I mean, what kind of innovations can you do as a learning company to, you know, help employees manage time as well as digital fatigue, you know, because you know that's setting in.
Yeah, if I can answer that slightly differently, Pooja, I think one of the big challenges that we're seeing in the country right now is for traditional businesses who are looking to digitize, how do they migrate the talent to become digital talent as well, I think is a big challenge. If you look around us, we are seeing, you know, bank websites go down, apps go down, you know, car companies struggling to be able to add computers into their vehicles because these are traditional businesses who are moving towards digital. You know, unlike Ina's organization, which has always been a technology-led business, these businesses have not necessarily been technology-led business. And as I was saying earlier, with 90% of businesses moving to digital, I think migrating talent towards being comfortable with using technology is a big challenge as well. And what we are working on is how do you take an auto company, how do you take a regular banking organization, how do you take a manufacturing company and build the capabilities around digital, around data? I think that's something that we are focused on quite a bit as well.
Sure, very interesting. So we are conscious of time, so we'll close this fireside chat. But viewers, please stay tuned to our website as we'll keep updating new fireside chats under this series of thought leadership series, which we're doing on the subject of reskilling. Thank you so much. Thank you, Ina. Thank you, Raghav.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pooja. Thanks, Raghav.